Well, good morning. It's good to have you in this morning. I pray that wherever you're at, that it's a good day. Sunday's always a good day. Praise the Lord. It's the first day of the week, and what better way to spend it than with the Lord. I know some of you will be watching this tonight. Some will be watching it tomorrow night, and we praise the Lord for those that are in Bogota, Colombia this morning listening. And it's a blessing to have you there, and I know you had 310 people there last week in church, and we praise the Lord for that. If there's one, if there's two, if there's 20, if there's 2,000, God's always in the midst. God's always right there with us. And I pray that the song says he's in the midst. And I pray that you'll never forget that God's in the middle of everything we do, for sure.
He's in the midst of our storm. He's in the valley we walk through. Where two or three are gathered in his name, he'll be there too. When you feel so all alone, he is standing next to you. He's with us now. Our Lord, he's in the midst. As you travel down life's way, he is with you every day. With every step you take, he walked ahead of you. And every night as you lay down, angels are camping all around. You'll never be alone, for he is in the midst. He's in the midst of our storm. He's in the valley we walk through. Where two or three are gathered in his name, he'll be there too. When you feel so all alone, he is standing next to you. He's with us now. Our Lord, he's in the midst. Doesn't matter where you're at, he's in the midst. Into the prison they were thrown. Paul and Silas weren't alone. They knew their God was there, and he would see them through. And when the walls began to shake, and all their chains just fell away, they cried, "Behold our Lord, for he is in the midst." He's in the midst of our storm. He's in the valley we walk through. Where two or three are gathered in his name, he'll be there too. When you feel so all alone, he is standing next to you. He's with us now. Our Lord, he's in the midst. He's with us now. He's in the midst.
Amen.
God's always there.
He is. All right. We have two hymns we're going to sing today. Welcome, everybody. First one is hymn 28, Greatest Thy Faithfulness, and there's a little bit of a change on the second hymn. It's hymn 60, We Will Sing the Wondrous Story, hymn 60. So, are we ready? Okay.
Thank you.
hymn 60, I will sing the wondrous story. It'll be intro and all verses. Singing along. Thank you, Deb.
Thank you.
Miss Bev will come with the scripture reading.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's a great day to be in the house of God.
Amen.
Our scripture today is Acts, from Acts 26, verse 11 to 20. And I punished them oft in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly mad against them, I persecuted them even unto strange cities. Whereupon, as I went to Damascus with authority and commission from the chief priests, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them which journeyed with me. And when we were all fallen to the earth, I heard a voice speaking unto me and saying in the Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And I said, Who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. But rise and stand upon thy feet, for I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness both of these things which thou hast seen and of those things in the which I will appear unto thee, delivering thee from the people and from Gentiles unto whom now I send thee, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins an inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. Whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient unto the heavenly vision, but showed first unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coasts of Judea, and then to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. May God bless the reading of his word.
Amen. Thank you, sister. Appreciate that. What a powerful passages of scripture there. The text verse is what we want to deal with mostly this morning, but we'll deal with the whole thing. We try to hit everybody in the building here this morning. Try to hit everybody in Brother Errol when he prayed for Sunday school. He said, "Don't let me pick on too many people." I like to pick on people because they pick back for sure. So I was going to preach on the Ten Commandments this morning, and I had two rebellious punks at the chili cook-off last night. They kept egging me on, and I told them I was going to preach on it, but I couldn't get it all together. I couldn't think of enough bad stuff to put in there. So I'm working on that, John, Tricia. Do yourself a favor and stay away from them if you can. It's not safe to be around them much. I'm learning that the hard way. That's why Evan's the way he is. He told me he goes home and just shakes. I can believe that. The story goes something like this. Her phone rings. The gentleman on the other end says, "Sweetheart, honey face, cutie pie, will you marry me?" She says, "Of course I'll marry you. Who is this?" Saul was on the road to Damascus. And he was stricken by a bright light. I don't know what the light was. I don't think it says what the light was. It was Jesus causing the light. He falls on the ground and he's blinded. And he says, "I'm your slave. I'll be your servant. I want you to be my master. Who is this? Who is this?" And the Lord said, his name was Saul still. He says, "Saul, Paul," same person, "I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest." Now think back. Have you ever read anywhere in the Bible where Paul attacked Jesus? I didn't. Did you ever read anywhere in the Bible where Paul cursed at Jesus? I didn't. He hit Jesus in the face, didn't he? Nope. You'll not find it there, I don't think. Did he ever throw a stone at Jesus? I threw some stones at people last week. Or week before, I missed them. But did Paul ever cast a stone at Jesus? I don't think so. Then how did he say, "I'm Jesus, here I am, you persecuted me"? Why could he say that? He said, Paul said, "I've never done anything to you, Jesus. I've never hurt you in a little bit." He said, "Paul, you're on your way to murder Christians. You're on your way to hurt my people. When you hurt my people, you hurt me. When you hit my people, you hit me. When you curse at my people, you curse at me." He said, "When you've done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me." He's saying this. "Paul, you hurt me bad, but I still love you." What a love story that is. You lift up your hand and to do harm, you're hurting Jesus this morning. Whenever you decided, whenever you were in bed last night or this morning, I hope you didn't have to do this. There's a bunch of people that did. I don't know about you, but I'll show you my appointment calendar. It's pretty busy. There's nothing there on Sunday. I've never had to write in on Sunday an appointment because I know Sunday's church day. And if you want to find me, you'll find me in church. If you want to come visit on Sunday morning, I'll feed you breakfast. No, I won't. Ralph will feed you breakfast. Go to his house. Ralph doesn't even fix breakfast. He goes to Morgansville Pancake Day. I heard a ruckus out there yesterday. It was Ralph Button in line, trying to get more pancakes where anybody else did. But he said, "How have I hurt you? I've never hurt you." I said, "Sure you have." And we this morning, listen to me now. We this morning, whenever you lift your voice at someone, you're hurting Jesus. Whenever you lift your hand to hurt someone, you're hurting Jesus. You're persecuting Jesus. And the text this morning said, it's hard to kick against the pricks. It's hard to kick against the pricks. The word pricks is where we get our word goad. You ever hear of an ox goad? Anybody ever hear of an ox goad? I knew a preacher. Well, he's old enough. Anybody ever heard of an ox goad? Bev, you ever hear of an ox goad? What's a goad? Good question. A goad is a long stick. This is biblical. You can look this up. It's a long stick, sort of like a tree branch. They would cut a branch off of a tree. And on the end of it, they put a sharp piece of metal. And this sharp piece of metal, whenever the oxen were working, if the oxen decided he was going to take a break, the farmer decided it wasn't taking time to take a break, he'd hit this oxen with the goad and it would take off again. Sort of like you put them on your heels. The cowboys did it. Spurs, sort of like spurs whenever you ride a horse. The horse decides he's going to be the boss. You decide you're the boss. You punch him with them spurs and he takes off. The ox goad was just that way. The farmer carried a stick. And on the end of it was this sharp piece of metal, and that's what he kept the oxen working with. You hit him, and he just takes off like a shot to the moon. All of a sudden he decides to stop. Have you ever worked around donkeys? Donkeys can be. We went to a basketball game one time, a donkey basketball game at North High years ago. And people rode donkeys and shot the baskets off of the donkey. And there was one that in the first period, he sat down in the middle of the floor and he wouldn't move. The whole basketball game, they had to go around this donkey in the middle of the floor. They couldn't get him to move. If they'd had a goad, they'd have made him move. The oxen going through the field was stop. He'd all of a sudden stop. I think I'll take a break. Oh, no, I guess I won't. Farmer wants me to work. So he gets back to work again. What Paul's trying to say is he wants it to be a big old ox. A big old ox. You wives have probably called your husbands that one time. You big ox, you, amongst other things. It's the same word. It's the exact same word. If you study it out, and I hope you do. If you study it out, it's the same word in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 when Paul talks about the sting of death. Where is thy sting, O grave? Where is thy victory? It wouldn't be a sting if something wouldn't happen. The bee don't just walk around thinking, I think I'm going to sting Errol this morning. Usually, have you ever been stung by a bee? I have. I've only been stung one time by a bee, and that was just a couple years ago. I avoided them my whole life, just about. But it hurts. Doesn't feel good. And Paul is saying, so it's wrong. It wouldn't be wrong to say, "O death, where is thy goad?" Instead of "O death, where is thy victory? Where is thy sting?" It's probably true that. Think about it. Probably true that to say that a majority of people fear death this morning. I don't know about you, but I've gotten to a realization that I'm a lot closer to the other side than I'm going back now. And you're not gonna scare me with a casket, because I'm not gonna be in there very long. Matter of fact, the part of me that's alive is not gonna be in there at all. I'm going to meet with Jesus. And Carolyn and Ruth and Avery and all of them that are going ahead of us and Dave. They're all standing there waiting for us. Dave's probably thinking of dumb jokes right now. That man can come up with some of the dumbest jokes you ever heard. But he'd tell you the joke, and it wasn't funny, but he'd laugh, and you'd laugh at him for laughing at the joke. It wasn't funny. That's the way he was. Yeah, that's what it was, for sure. Jesus is saying, the goad or death is sin. We all live in the world of sin. We don't have to. We have to live in the world. We don't have to be of the world, for sure. Did you know that the bee, this is true, I never knew this, bee can only sting one person. After that, he loses his stinger, and he can't sting anybody else. And you know death is like that. It can only sting one person. We need to make sure that person, and I'm not talking about physical death. I'm talking about spiritual death. Spiritual death. It's your fault, brother. It's your fault, sister, if you let the stinger in you. It's your fault if you get so close that the bee stings you, so to speak. So what happened at Calvary? Jesus was taking the stinger out of death. That's all it was. Jesus was taking the stinger out of death so that I wouldn't have to go to hell. You know, there's an awful lot about hell in the Bible. There's a lot more about hell in the Bible than there is about heaven. Why is that? Because Jesus doesn't want us to go to hell. Jesus wants us to go to heaven. If you go to hell, it's your fault. You're not going to be able to make excuses. Well, that preacher, nope, wasn't a preacher. Well, church was too early. Nope. You get up early enough to watch a ball game if a ball game is on. It's too cold in church. There's people 30 below zero watching the Super Bowl, watching the football playoff games. Mr. Buddy, you'd have to pay me more. You'd have to pay me $1 million. No, you wouldn't. You have to pay me $2 million to go to a football game set in 30-degree weather. Some of those dipsticks had their shirts off. That's crazy. That's crazy. You big ox. At first, that seems cruel to call somebody a big ox. But it went, back in the Bible days, the ox was the most valuable animal that the household had. Because he was a worker. But he could have said, you old bull, you good for nothing lamb. You're like an old goat. I called a guy an old goat one time, he about hit me. But he called him an ox. What Jesus was trying to say was, no matter what you've done, listen to me now. No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, no matter how hard your life has been, no matter what you've said, no matter who you've cursed, doesn't matter who you've wronged, I can still use you. I can still use you. It's God saying, you haven't gone low enough that I can't reach down and pick you up. You haven't said enough bad things that I can't save your soul and use you for Christ. There's little snotty-nosed kids that crawl off the bus. That mess the church all up. Stick bubble gum underneath the seats. You ain't lived till you fold your legs up underneath the seat of a pew and get stuck by a bazooka. Whenever you get stuck by a bazooka, you know you've been in a bus kid's seat. Some of them are as bad can be. Praise God, God sees potential in them. God sees them as he wants to see them. You get that same bad kid, as bad can be. You put that same kid that stole from you. You get that same bad kid that cursed you and used bad language around you. You get that same bad kid that come in your house and messed your house up or soaped your windows up or whatever it might be. And you teach him about the person of Christ, and he'll punch the devil in the nose. I guarantee you he'll punch the devil in the nose. Preacher, you sound like you're mad. I am mad. I'm mad at people not getting along with people. There's no reason that one of us in this room have any reason to get mad at anybody, any one of us. We're all on the same team. It'd be like the batter hitting the ball and the pitcher running and catching the guy going to first base before he gets there. Or the coach coming in and grabbing the guy before he ran. You hit a ball to the fence. And you're around first base, headed for second, the coach all of a sudden comes out and picks you up and takes you back to the dugout. That'd be crazy. That's what we Christians do. We Christians hit the ball, so to speak. And, well, did you see how she did that? Did you hear what she said? Did you see that book on her coffee table while we were there? I bet she smoked a cigarette, too. There's worse things in life than smoking cigarettes. And we do them. I'm not condoning smoking cigarettes. I'm not condoning the lady that don't know when to put the music on. Or the guy sitting beside him. Or that's two of a kind back there. Mutt and Jeff from Abbott and Costello. The worst person in Hagerstown. Listen to me now, and I mean this. Sound like Joe Biden. I'll get put in jail for that. The worst person in Hagerstown is as welcome here as you are. Whoever walks in that door, we're going to welcome them in. We're going to set them down. We're going to preach at them. We're going to talk to them. We're going to befriend them. He or she has the potential to be a big ox for God. We sometimes look on each other, and we're pretty hard on each other. We can have some awful ways to us. We can say some awful things to people. But I found out that there's nobody any better than I am in this building, and I'm a lot better off than people are, but I'm no better than anybody else. And I can tell stories upon stories. I praise the Lord, I'm not bragging. I got 7 kids that we used to bring on the bus that are pastors across America. And one of them was, I've told you different times about little Frankie boy. People in church hated him. They hated to see him come in the door because they knew he was going to create a problem. If you walk past the bathroom and there's water on the floor, Frankie boy stuffed toilet paper down the commode and stuffed it up. I never will forget, there was a water fountain in the hallway. Frankie boy put a piece of paper in the squirty hole, and the pastor of the church came, got a drink, and squirted and got all over his tie down the front of his shirt. And he just laughed it off and kept on going because he knew who it was. It was Frankie boy. It was Frankie boy. Frankie boy was the one that said, said, "Mr. John, I'm going to steal your wife." He was like 8 years old. He said, "Me and Miss Ruth, we're like that. We're like that. I'm taking her away from you. She's going to run off on you." I said, "You better not." Ruth said, "I'm going to." And her and Frankie got off the bus, and I shut the door and went about 3 bus lengths down the road, and the kid said, "Are you letting her there?" "No, we're not letting her there. I'm going back to get her." I made out like I was going to fight little Frankie boy, and he put his arms up. He said, "I love you, Mr. John, but I'm going to steal your wife." People hated to see him come to church. He on his deathbed, he passed. On his deathbed, he had his mom call me. He said, "Mr. John, I'm going to see my Ruthie. I'm going to see my Ruthie." I said, "Are you leaving right now? Because I want to get there first if I can." He said, "I beat you again, didn't I?" That's the last thing he said to me. I beat you again. Sometimes something else about the ox. The ox was only made for one purpose. The ox wasn't made to be beautiful. He was made to work. A Chihuahua dog was made to be pretty. You know them little ankle biters? He was made to be pretty, but I bet, no, we're Baptists, we can't bet. I wager that you've never seen a Chihuahua dog pulling a plow through the field. You've not pulled your car over and said, "Look at that dear little Chihuahua dog over there pulling that big old plow." You've never seen that. But the ox does it all the time. The ox is not happy unless he's serving. And I guarantee you, the Christian is not happy unless he's serving. You need to be at it for Christ. You can set and take up 18 inches, 20 inches, 25 inches, 3 feet of the pew if you want to. But you'll never be happy until you serve God. You'll never be happy. Amongst the serving was the thing the ox was born for, was made to do. He wasn't made to lay down and like cows do under the tree and wait for the rain. He was working day and night. I got a list of things for you to do around the church if you want to be an ox. I'd love to look at you and say, "You big ox, you." Could I say that this morning? God didn't make you to be pretty. If he did, it didn't work. You see what I see from up here? It scares you. Brother Evan, you're the bouncer. Throw her out of here, will you? He won't even obey. You got a security person that won't even listen. Should have known she's from West Virginia. Okay. He didn't make you to be a chihuahua. He made you to be an ox. Are you an ox this morning? You might think I'm crazy, but you know I'm right. You know I'm right. God wants you to be a servant. God wants you to be at it day and night. You say, preacher, why you work so many hours? Because I want to be a servant of God. I don't want to be a lazy person. I want to be a go-getter for God. God said to Paul, you want to be a servant? I may have to stick you a little bit. Paul, you're like everybody else. You get tired. But if you stop, I got the goad here ready for you. I'm going to stick you and punch you, make you go. You read the life of Paul, he was punched a lot. I still think everywhere Paul went, every town he went to, they had a cell in his name. If the town had a bunch of criminals in it, they'd keep one cell open because they knew Paul was coming through and they'd go throw him in it. He suffered like nobody else suffered as a Christian. Yet he kept on going for Christ. I may have to stick you a couple times, Paul. What do? We growl because we get stuck once. We growl because everything isn't as good as we thought it would be. We growl, well, God, it's not fair. You know what's not fair? Us treating God the way we treat God. That's what's not fair. We think we have it so tough. Listen to me now, and I'm done. With all my heart, I believe many people. Let me say this, and I'll come back to that. What happened when the question was, what happened when the ox wouldn't obey the goad? Once in a while, you stick the ox and he wouldn't go. You stick him again and he wouldn't go. You stick him again and he wouldn't go. What would happen then? The farmer would kill him. They'd butcher him. Use him for meat. I firmly believe, I'm dead serious, I firmly believe that many people go to heaven early because they won't serve God. And God jabs them a little bit and still won't go. God jabs them again, and he still won't go. God stabs them the third time, and he still won't go. God says, angels, just go ahead and go down and get her and bring her up here. Go down and get him and bring him up here. I can use him up here. Many people, I believe, are in heaven early because they would not obey God. All God's asking is for our time. Who gives us our time anyhow? God does. If you got out of bed at all this morning, well, you did because you're here. But if you tried to decide, if you had to decide, I'll put it that way. If you had to decide this morning whether you're coming to Sunday school or not, you better look out, because God's got his ox goad out ready to hit you with it. It shouldn't be a choice. It's Sunday morning. It's church time. Sunday morning is church time. That's why my calendar never has anything on Sundays. I venture to say most of us in here don't put anything on our calendars on Sundays because it's church day. You want to find me? Find me at church. You want to come early? Come early. And you can stay at the house and guard the house, or you can come to church with me. That's the way it's going to be, but we're going to church. Why? I don't want God sticking me with that stick, so to speak. I want to be on the good side of God, fulfilling the purpose of why we're here. I'm convinced for sure that whenever we're done with our purpose, God takes us home. God takes us home. Are you Chihuahua? Or are you an oxen this morning? It's your choice. Your choice. Paul, I'll be your servant, or God, I'll be your servant. I'll be your slave. I'll be your master. You'll be my master. Who are you? I hope God can't come to us and say, I'm Jesus, whom thou persecutest. Before you say that nasty thing to me, to your neighbor, to your boss, to your wife, to your husband, to your kids, remember when you hurt somebody else, you hurt God. I think of the story, and I'm closing. This is the second time. Sherry always said, you close three times, on the third time you're going to close. This is the second closing. I think of the story years ago at Grace. I was preaching about something, and one of the deacons got up, and his wife had gotten for some reason his wife was sitting on one side and the deacon was sitting on the other side, and his wife got a hold of him by eye. You know that eye that they give you? Wives have that eyeball. And when they look at you, boy, you better listen. It's like Popeye eating spinach. She gave him that eye, and that meant the little one's acting up. He mistook the eye for something else. He got up and grabbed that little one out of the seat, took him downstairs and spanked him. And the whole time while he was going through the church, the little one kept saying, pray for me, I didn't do anything this time. He went down, his dad spanked him, brought him up, and the wife said, what'd you spank him for? He said, you give me that eye. He said, no, that's the wrong eye. That's the wrong eye. You hurt that little one? You hurt him on purpose? Now, I'm not saying you can't spank your children. I think it's good to spank myself. I got spanked a lot. See how good I am? But I'm saying whenever you hurt somebody, whenever you gossip about somebody, and gossip isn't gossip just because it's bad. Gossip is gossip because it's bad or good. If I need to say something to Sister Bev, I better say it to Sister Bev, right to her face. Not talk behind her back. Or hurt them in any way. You want to get on the wrong side of someone easy? Get between a mother and her kids. Man, they'll give you that eye real quick. At least the eye. That's the way it was whenever we were on the bus. They come up to the little Frankie boy and said, I want you to sit on the back seat. I don't want you to go any further. I said, I brought him to church. I took him right up front with me and set him right down beside me. They hated that little kid. But I tell you, I seen him lead his mother and his father and his brother to the Lord. Who are we to say that who's going to be right and who's going to be wrong? It's God's choice. God sees the inside. We only see the outside. I mean, if I judge you on the outside this morning, well, Brother Mike, you'd be right beside Paul in prison. But he didn't hear me. Isn't God good? God's good in spite of us. And I don't know about you, I want to be an ox for God. I don't want to be a Chihuahua dog, for sure. Can we pray together, Father? The choice is ours to make. I pray that we wouldn't be the Chihuahua dog, that we would be the ox. If we have to stand by ourselves, we'd be the ox. If we have to be the one that takes the grunt of the punishment, it'd be us, we'd be the ox. You love Paul and you love us just as much. You love the you not only love the lovely, but you love the unlovely. You love the one that is hard to reach. It's hard to love. The one that'll curse to you. one that'll stab you in the back when you walk out of their house. You love them too. Mr. John, I'm going to steal your wife. What a time we had on the bus with him. What a time I'm going to have in heaven when I get there with him. Problem is, that's not really a problem. The issue is getting there. It's not really an issue either. It's just accepting me in your heart. Aren't you glad, with head bowed and eyes closed, aren't you glad you don't have to have $1 million in the bank to go to heaven? Aren't you glad you don't have to be a certain color, speak a certain language, wear a certain kind of clothes to go to heaven? God doesn't care what kind of car you drive if you come in a buggy. What God cares about is that you give your heart to him. If you can remember a place in your life when you gave your heart to Christ, then praise God for it. If you can't remember the place that you got saved, I wouldn't take a chance. I'd come this morning and get saved. Come this morning and make sure. For salvation, for rededication, for baptism, for church membership, just to come to pray, the invitation is wide open to you. It's easier now than ever because no one's even going to see you come. Won't you step out for Christ if you need to? We're going to wait a few seconds and we're going to dismiss. We're going to turn the lights out. We're going to go home. Don't let us do that. Just soon stay all day. Heavenly Father, I pray that every one of us in here are an ox for Jesus. God could look at us and say, you big ox, you. What a privilege. What a privilege. Father, I pray for safety as we go. Let us be the soul winner we need to be. Let us talk to that person that we think we can't. We can do it through your power. Bless us, keep us, bring us back next week as our prayer and our plea. As in Jesus' name we say, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. As you go about the week, you go about what you do, you go to the bank, you go to the car wash, you go to McDonald's, you go to the car wash, you go back to McDonald's, you go to bed, you get up in the morning, go back to McDonald's. Don't do anything dumb. And don't forget, there's always somebody has it harder than you have it. Give them a smile, give them a pat on the back, give them a hug, tell them that you love them. It'll help you more than it helps them, for sure. Praise the Lord. Thank you for coming. You are dismissed.